We actually have two guest speakers that are going to be presenting today. And one thing I'm really excited about this is I feel like they're much more qualified than I am to teach this class. So this is Carrie and Ryan. And Carrie actually used to be in this ward before she went on to, well, she got married and graduated, I guess you could say. But Carrie has been a marriage and family counselor for how many years now? Or is that the incorrect title?
A clinical social worker for 8 years.
Okay, great. And I have two experiences with Carrie that I'd like to share real quick. One is I had some friends that had, we all had these kind of marriage questions, and I remember asking Carrie once, she recommended that we read a book. And right after that, one of my friends said, I owe my marriage to that book, so I was really appreciative to Carrie for that. And then my second experience is I was listening to a study on the radio about marriage, and in that study, they actually quoted Carrie's work. So I thought that was pretty cool. So anyway, I'm going to turn the time over to them, and we'll get started with the class. And I'm just going to sit here doing the audio-visual controls.
All right. So, like you said, we were in this ward 2 years ago. We were unmarried. We were engaged. He was 32. I was 31.
Yeah.
We had to get special permission to stay in the ward because, you know, whatever. So, what we wanted to do is we were going to share just a little bit about us, and actually wanted to create a Q&A situation. So, Miguel, how does that work? Were they next to you?
I'll write the number up on the board.
So, we're just going to tell like the 5 to 7 minute version of how we met, so you just know us. And then, but I really want to know what is a concern for you, or what's something that you want to know more about.
And we have a bunch of stuff prepared. And so if we don't have a lot of questions, we'll kind of just go along with a few things we have prepared, but we'd rather have questions. So,
yeah.
Yeah, so for those of you who were not here last week, there's a number that you can text into to ask an anonymous question, and I will write this up on the board shortly.
Great.
So we're kind of like, it's a little bit different because Carrie professionally has a lot of this experience, which is amazing, and so some of your questions might be directed to her a little more, but we also kind of want to be personal too because like our story might be kind of like yours. You know, we were both single for a long time, now we're married, so we're just going to share a little bit about that. Here's what I'm kind of explain a little more about kind of the purpose of what we hope you to get out of this.
Okay. So specifically, I might share some therapeutic skills or content, or some communication skills, but besides that, it's just kind of up to you guys. So, whatever you want. So, let's see. We both have been in love multiple times, both had pretty bad heartbreaks that caused us, I feel like after one of my heartbreaks, I had to go to therapy and get on medication, and had a nice long string of bad relationships, and but we started dating, and right when Ryan moved here.
Yeah, we met online, and it wasn't as common, we met about 5 years ago, so it was kind of like not as common as it is now, but we met online. I just moved to Utah, going to grad school at the U. We started dating pretty quickly. Actually, I just moved to Utah, and we met just a couple weeks later. And we kind of hung out for a little bit, but I kind of made an effort, and this is, you know, like we hear about this all the time, like dating, hanging out, all that stuff, or whatever. Like at first, we just hung out, and then I remember inviting Carrie to do something with just me. I didn't like say, do you want to go on a date, you know, but I was just kind of feeling things out. So we spent some time together, one-on-one, a few times, and that's when I kind of realized, okay, she keeps saying yes to that, so she must kind of like me, all right. So we dated for 2.5 years. I don't recommend that. It's too long, honestly, and it was mostly my fault. Carrie could probably tell you more about that, and we don't have to go into it too much. But we dated for a long time. And we probably could have gotten married sooner than we did.
But we were scared out of our minds.
Yeah. So, I guess in a kind of a personal level, some of you might have fears about long-term relationships, about marriage, things like that, and we did too, so we can relate. It's part of the reason why we didn't get married sooner. But yeah, we've been married for about 2 years, and yeah, it's been great. It really has. So, that's kind of our story. So, what do we want to do from here?
Okay. So, do you know if we have questions yet? Can you see?
Yes. First question.
Can I actually read them instead of just... What was the book I recommended to you, Miguel?
It was Attached.
Attached. Oh, gosh. That is such a great book. Yeah. So the book I recommended to Miguel is called Attached. Has anyone else read that? Nice. Awesome book. I cannot remember who the authors are, but it has magnets in the shapes of hearts on the front.
It's by Amir Levine.
Thank you.
Amir
Levine. Isn't there two authors, though?
I can't remember the second one.
Yeah. And then what was the other one?
That was the only question.
The one above it wasn't the question? Okay. All right, great.
So, well, hopefully we get some questions, but I wanted to talk a little bit about my kind of experience with relationships, less professional and clinical, but when Miguel asked us to speak, I thought a little bit about kind of on our experiences, and I wanted to talk a little bit about faith, so kind of more of the gospel side of relationships and marriage and stuff. There was a talk that popped into my head, and then I read the talk, and nothing from the talk really was what I wanted to share, but it was kind of just like the idea behind the talk that really stuck with me, and that was The Challenge to Become from Elder Oaks. And so I read it, and it doesn't necessarily have to do with relationships and marriage, but what kind of stuck out to me is that, you know, this life is a process. This life, we're always, hopefully, you know, we're changing all the time. You know, it could be for the positive, for the negative, whatever, but we're always moving forward. And I guess kind of looking at some fears that people may have of, you know, am I going to find the right person to marry? That might be a fear that some of you may have. Or, you know, am I going to fall out of love with the person I'm married to? I think the thing that stuck with me is that we're always going to be changing, and that should be our goal. You know, like the day I married Carrie, things weren't set in stone. Like, we've changed so much since when we got married. And we dated for, like I said, 2.5 years, so we knew each other pretty well before. But at the same time, like, there's just so much that's kind of unexpected. You don't know how you're going to be when you're in that marriage relationship. And so...
it's really different from dating.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. And so, I guess what I kind of learned from my history in my life is that worrying about controlling kind of the unknowns of my future kind of got in the way of my happiness. And some examples of that, and I guess this should be kind of embarrassing to learn, but I don't really care, is that, like, when I was dating, I was kind of a shy guy, and I wouldn't ask a girl out unless I was pretty much 99% sure she was going to say yes. So I was kind of like trying to take the unknown out of dating or relationships, right? Like, in the last slide, I was sure I wasn't going to take that risk. And then, after dating Carrie for a long time, it took a little bit of an ultimatum. I knew I wanted to marry Carrie. For some reason, I couldn't quite get the guts up to ask her until she said, "You better ask me to marry you. We're going to break up." So, and then even still.
Even then.
I
said,
her.
"By Christmas or it's over."
Yeah.
New Year's, January.
First week of January. I was just totally good.
Yeah.
But, yeah. Let's see. Maybe any questions?
So we actually have
a clip to play too.
So, let's take care. So, we want to hear about this.
Oh, okay, so each one is a different set of questions. Okay,
yeah.
I just got that. That's a great question. Oh, these are such great questions. Wow, those are really good, yeah.
Also, we didn't say, like, you guys can make comments too.
Out loud too.
No, we're millennials. We don't talk.
Yeah. Okay, Sean.
Just text.
Okay, so this question is, how should couples navigate resolutions when someone in the relationship is upset? Is it possible to safely find resolve when someone is emotionally charged upset? Super great question. And I think if you understand the answer to this question, you're probably going to have a happy marriage. Like, this is so big. This is such a big deal. I would say, I need the board. Okay, I would say that like 85% of the couples who come in and talk to me, it could be him or it could be her, but it's usually her. She says, I have this complaint and I'm really worried and I'm just upset because of this. And he, his accidental immediate first response is, he becomes, his heart starts racing, he becomes defensive, and he struggles to see, not that he's failed, but she came to him for the solution. And so his immediate response accidentally re-triggers for her this internal, oh no, here we go again, he doesn't care about me, he doesn't really care about what I'm feeling, and he just needs to understand, all I'm saying is, I just wish that we didn't spend every Sunday night at your parents till midnight. That's all I'm saying. Well, you've never liked my mom anyways. And anyway, so I would say this is like 80% of couples who come in where when a wife brings up something that she wants, I would say the other 20% is when the man's bringing up something. The wife brings up something that she's really wanting to have heard or understood or is longing to be connected with him about, and he is really struggling to not jump to his first emotional reaction. And when I say that first emotional reaction, so this is common list, so whine, complain, lecture, judge, check out, stonewall, belittle, sarcasm, whatever your first sort of like external behavior thing is what, obviously there are lots of times when you're going to say, can we do this, and you and your spouse are going to go along, fine. But when it's not going to work, it's usually because someone's going to have a bigger internal reaction where they're not sure how to make it right. And I would say usually this person's internal dialogue is, see, I can't do anything right. All that can happen is she brings up problems. So I feel like two really important things. So many important things. One really important thing is if somebody's coming to you and trying to bring up a concern and a problem, the best thing you can do is shelve all of your feelings and close them in a drawer and really try to listen for a minute without responding or reacting. And I know that sounds simple, but you will be so surprised how difficult it is when it's actually something that's very triggering. If you can do that and your first response is to not become defensive and try to respond, you're gonna end up in a much better place. So they say, like, you can tell within the first 60 seconds of a conversation whether or not it's gonna end in a fight or end resolved, because your initial response is that important to who you wanna talk to about what's going on. So just pointing that out.
I have a question.
Yeah.
On the other side, mm-hmm. The person giving the complaint or, you know, trying to fix something, is there a way to present it to the first person so they don't feel as defensive?
Right. So I would say that usually when this happens and I go, Ryan, wah! And he goes, wah! And his defenses go up, either that means, one, I could have been, the word that the industry uses is called gentle startup. So if I miss my gentle startup,
I'll back it up to gentle startup. And I'll go, oh, so listen, I'm not trying to say that you're not doing a great job. I'm just, and I lower my tone, talk slower. They call it slow and low. And then if I can even physically touch him, his heart rate is going to lower. He's going to feel more safe and connected with me. And then he's going to feel like we can actually talk about it instead of having some of the physical responses. Well, both of ours are to bounce away from each other when we're upset. Yeah.
There's a really good book called Crucial Conversations that kind of goes through that.
That is a great
book.
It's
really helpful.
Yeah.
And it's easy to read.
It is an easy to read.
Okay.
Being how do couples navigate resolution when someone's upset? So the answer is, one, if someone's upset, you need to become really gentle and try to be a very safe place for them. Second, if they're upset and they need to calm down, if they're having a hard time calming down, so like if this is a little chart here and this is our stress level when we get into a conflict, you have this area here before someone becomes flooded. Once they're flooded, they have lost ability to be here, and they're back here in an emotional part of their brain. And no matter what you say, no matter how hard you're trying to get them to connect with you and just understand, I'm just trying to say, can't you just see, this isn't about that, I'm so sorry. They are not going to be there. So you have like this build-up piece until they go here. So if you can catch them before here, best thing possible. If you can't, probably what you need to do is take a break, say, and the rule is when you take a break, you say how long it is and when you'll be back. And both people need to be actively trying to calm themselves down. Research says you should not need more than 90 minutes to calm yourself down. And whoever needed that break, the other person is going to be in emotional anxiety and turmoil during that whole time. So recognizing that if you're going to go take a break or if that break needs to happen, the kindest thing you can do is talk about it as soon as possible for them. And I would say that if most people actually take the break, again, the rule being you have to say, I need a break, and then two, that you will be back to it. I just, give me 10 minutes, give me 15 minutes. This isn't let's talk about it tomorrow, which is hard when you don't live together, right? But it's going to help a lot. And then you can come back in with a more calm physical place, and you have done your own calming, and they have done their own calming. And again, if you can be physically touching that person and talk slow, and though you're going to get better off. Is that answered?
Let's move on, just
because. Moving on. Okay.
It's a little time.
It's true. Okay. What helped you get over your fear of marriage? Did anything change?
Oh, we were going to talk about that.
Yeah.
Anyways.
Yeah.
So.
Let's see. I specifically remember standing out or being out in the parking lot of this building, together, and I 100% have to say that we consciously chose to be completely afraid and do the thing that we thought was the right thing, which was try to make it work.
Yeah, so I guess the answer is we didn't necessarily get over our fear completely.
No.
To some degree.
There are no safe guarantees in a relationship. There's no person you're going to marry that you're 100% sure is going to be there for you. So it's always great when you see people who are like totally look unafraid to get married. That is so not us. I knew that we would, like, I was like, barfing while I was engaged, you know? Like, the day of my wedding shower, I was like lying on my bed, like, I can't do this, it's so hard. But if I let that feeling guide me, I'm gonna end up somewhere I don't wanna be. It can change my behavior. We were both really conscious about talking about how we were feeling and choosing, you know what, even though we're afraid, and like the image of us being in the parking lot I had is we're both sitting in the car and we're both like just totally overwhelmed, totally afraid. And I like remember this image of like feeling like my guts had been split open and I was like holding them and I was like trying to like hold them away from him. Like, don't look at these because they're so scary and I'm so afraid. And like him the same. And it was a conscious choice to like turn towards each other and be like, here are my guts, will you hold them with me? And him be like, here's mine, and we're like holding intestines together. We're like, all right, let's go. And that's how it felt.
So I guess that's sort of the answer. We talked about it too. We admitted to each other that we were afraid, but that it was what we wanted to do, and we felt like it was the right thing, and we weren't so afraid that we let it stop us. And some of that continues on in marriage, right? Like, you're still sometimes, after you have a fight or an argument, or you're like, I'm kind of afraid that I chose the wrong person, but I'm now sealed to this person, okay. But those things pass. Like, that's part of life, you know? Like, that's normal.
And then they come back. Yeah. I would say, whatever you're afraid of right now, you will still be afraid of when you're married. Because that's just kind of the way we do fears as humans. We're like, the thing I've been afraid of is something I've been afraid of since I was really little. He just happens to trigger it every now and then. Right? So, like, being afraid of marriage, that's not, or like, not wanting to be divorced, that's not something that I've just been afraid of since we've been married. Like, that's like a long-term thing that's been on my mind. Similarly, the worry that, like, maybe he's not the right person, maybe there's someone else out there for me, maybe he'll cheat on me, maybe we'll get divorced. Like, those fears do not necessarily go away just because of who you've picked. It's more about understanding and owning, that is my fear. That's going with me no matter who I'm with. Doesn't matter who I'm with, that's how I'm going to feel. I'm going to feel that fear. That script is going to be running, that's been running for a really long time, because that's just something that happens for me. So it happens for me, those scripts come up again. If we're in a fight or disagreeing, or he's been kind of mean that day, the scripts will come back and be like, well, maybe you should have been with somebody else. Maybe this isn't going to work out. And it would be really easy, again, to buy into that fear or buy into those thoughts and be like, because I'm having them, it's going to happen. I knew it. I shouldn't have done this. Or I could just see them for what they are. These are the fears I've had a long time. These are the scripts and the things in my pattern that have been running in my head a long time. And they'll be here no matter whether I'm with him or with somebody else.
And I think I wanted to say, like, you may know people who've been divorced. You know, you may have seen bad examples of relationships, marriage, things like that. I mean, and so that kind of can start to weigh on people who are trying to get in relationships. And I've seen that with people I'm close to who kind of carry that with them, that extra fear. And it can be, I mean, that can be a real serious thing. And I guess my challenge for you, coming from like a non-clinical point of view, someone who's single for a long time, is just try a little bit to be a little less cynical, maybe about marriage, just a little, and try not to, I guess, focus on the faults of your partner, because they're going to be there, and maybe turn inward a little bit and focus a little more on yourself. Because, I mean, there's no one out there who's perfect for you. You know, there's not someone. And that's, sometimes I got hung up on that. Like, I have these things that I really wish we had more in common. Question?
Yeah, I was just wondering, like, what advice do you have when, I feel like sometimes when the times that arguments get the worst are when two people are feeling their most exhausted or their most vulnerable and scared, and it's not, it's obviously nice if one person is feeling stronger than the other and can kind of be more gentle and compassionate and caring. But, like, if things are bad, you're both feeling that way. What is your advice for kind of working through those moments together?
I love what you said. It's 100% true. If you're having a hard day or if you're struggling, your partner, if you have a good attachment with them, they will be feeling that. Even if they were having an okay day, if I come home and I'm like, rawr, then Ryan's like, and we are so emotionally connected that we feel so much of the same thing. I think we have noted our pattern of how we talk like that. And I have one thing that I know that I will say when I know that I cannot be the strong one today. I will say, I need you, and it will be very obvious, I need you to be the one who helps me now. Because I can't be the one that's helping right now. I've been helping people all day long. I need you to be the one. Can we watch a video really quick? Okay. I want to use this video. The video is pretty simple, but I really like it because it talks about, yes, that one. It's called How to Complain Without Hurting Your Partner's Feelings. And she says three things. It's about, I feel what you need. Why you feel it. You just go. Three
minutes. When we studied how couples brought up problems, we videotaped these 3,000 couples, what we saw was that they followed basically three rules. Three typical behaviors. For couples who made it work, who made lasting relationships, here's what they did. Step one, they always started with I. And it was usually, I'm upset, or I'm worried, or I'm angry. So it was I plus some kind of feeling. And, you know, if they didn't know, you know, if they didn't know from feelings, what feeling is what feeling, which one, they just say I'm upset, because again, as I mentioned earlier, upset covers everything. So they'd say I'm upset, and then about what? Step two is about what? And the about what part was really interesting, because they wouldn't say I'm upset that you're such an idiot. They wouldn't do that. They wouldn't go blaming, right? They would say something that was, again, more factual. They talk about the facts. I'm upset that the garbage hasn't been taken out. I'm angry that there's a new dent in the car. I'm furious. So they could be angry. Anger was okay. I'm furious that the bills haven't been paid. Okay? So they were not describing their partner. They were describing themselves. And then describing the situation that they were upset about. That was the trick. And finally, the third step is that they would say what they needed. How could their partner make it better? How could their partner shine for them? So they said what they needed. I need you to take out the garbage. I need you to drive more carefully so our car will be protected. So they would say what they needed, and I know that that's something that's really, really hard for us, especially in this culture, because after all, we're all individuals, we're all self-sufficient, we don't need anybody from any, you mean nothing, right? Ha ha ha. We are all pack animals. As little human beings. And we do need each other. That's the reality. We die if we don't have connection with other people. You take infants and isolate them, they die. You can give them all the food and water they need, they will die. We need touch. We need connection. We need each other. That's just the reality. There's no such thing as too needy. No such thing. Everybody has needs. That's who we are. That's how we're built.
Thanks. So I think, again, to reiterate, if you can get better before you ever start your complaint, before you ever start that frustration, at knowing what you need before you start, rather than just starting with a complaint. I'm angry, I'm mad. If you don't know what you need, they can't make it better for you. And I've found that I rarely know what I needed before I started complaining. It's really changed things for me to have what I need first, because then it makes it really easy, actually, for the solution to be found. And then he spends a lot less time in anxiety and defensiveness when I'm able to share it.
So, I have another question. Well, while you're reading that one, so there was a question about what kind of gospel principles helped us in our relationship. And I think the two that kind of come to mind are faith, which, you know, is such a kind of broad thing, but just that faith that kind of gives you hope that things are going to be okay when things seem scary or frustrating. And I'd say, you know, forgiveness and the atonement, and not like the big, huge forgiveness, but just the everyday, day-to-day kind of little stuff. Being, you know, these type of situations, you know, being quick to forgive, and just, yeah, for me at least, trying to get over those things as quickly as possible and kind of move on.
There's an interesting question here that talks about, basically this person says, I'm not sure how to deal with sarcasm. I feel like I'm really sensitive and it comes up in dating, and I find I'm being hard about myself, or someone pokes fun at me, it's hard for me to take it personally, or to not take it personally. I would say this, there is no person that you are going to marry who doesn't have a bruise or a sore spot on their body, and you're going to have your own bruises and your own sore spots. That when you go there, it's and you accidentally rub it, you're going to get a big response from them, and it could be something more severe than sarcasm. It could be, you know, they may have really issues with feeling physically secure or safe with you, or they may have felt a lot of abandonment, or they may have felt a lot of like they were never a priority or important. And whenever that is tripped in a relationship, be it sarcasm or something else, and I'm touching him because it's like sometimes you're going along, you know, just peering, and you hit a bruise and you get a huge reaction from somebody. It's really important to be able to build what's safe for that relationship. And so to be able to say, hey, I really struggle with sarcasm. It's really tough for me. I just prefer a kind tone. That is great. The problem is, once somebody hits your bruise, it's like you've been incapacitated, right? So I think it's a great skill to learn how to go back to somebody the day after or the week after and give feedback. Or after you've had a big fight and you've finally calmed down for it, going to your partner and then giving the feedback. Hey, remember last week when we talked about that? I did not know what to say. I was totally blah. I've been thinking, and this is what I've been thinking about. This is what I really need. This is what I'd really like. And those are really the hardest conversations to have. I remember one time I could not get out the words. And he was like, tell me. And I was like, because it's so vulnerable, so hard. I sat down and I started typing on the computer. And I typed it out. And I'm crying the whole time. I'm
just email each other sometimes.
Yeah. And I hand it to him and he reads it. And then he's able to respond to me. But that ability to take the thing that you know is most tender and treat it tenderly. Again, it's that guts thing. Like, will you hold these with me? I know they're really gross, but can you help me with them? I would say that's, yeah, great.
We don't have a ton of time. There's just a couple of those things that we wanted to talk about. Okay, what's another question, or do you want to talk
about? Oh, yeah. I don't know. Well, do you guys want me to talk about deal breakers or things for sure we don't want in a relationship?
Yep, I like it.
Yeah. We got one, two thumbs up on
this.
Do it. Okay, three thumbs, five thumbs up. Okay, so I would say that abuse is a deal breaker.
Yeah, I was reading in the news about, not gonna be like politics, about White House staffer and some of that stuff. And I was like, oh, Carrie, you haven't read about this yet, but, and not that we're gonna spend a whole time talking about it, but physical abuse, that's a deal breaker.
And emotional?
Yeah. Oh, any abuse. Financial abuse, emotional abuse,
that?
Verbal abuse.
Or is that a discussion?
Okay, so that's a great question. So I think it's really important, one, to get in the habit of giving a lot of feedback. Because if we tally up all of the diagnostic criteria and all of this stuff, and then we tally up all of the people who maybe don't necessarily have that all the time or whatever, we think it's probably, we're talking like, there's probably a good 70% of the whole population that if you married, you'd probably be really, really, really happy with them, really okay. And then there's a potential that there's like maybe 30% of people who might not be as healthy for you to marry. So what you're looking for when you're dating somebody is, do they try to be a better person and respond better when I have given feedback? So you cannot take something like, I'm sure there are things that really rub me the wrong way. Don't need to share that. Okay. So, and my reaction was so big, I was like, I'm breaking up with him. I do not want to have this. I am not going to deal with this in a relationship or marriage. And my roommates are like, yeah, you shouldn't have to put up with that. You're right. You deserve better. Hate that line. Hate that line now. I think that's not a helpful line unless it's abuse, true abuse. I gave him feedback. I said, listen, this is super sensitive subject to me. You will never say something like that to me again because it was so hurtful and so painful. I cannot even handle that. And he was like, okay. And he adjusted. Now that tells me he wasn't abusive, but he was able to adjust to me. And that's great, right? That I have clients who they go home and they say, well, I just really feel like we should do this. And they get no positive response. It's blaming on you. It's you need to fix this. If you would just do this, this wouldn't be a problem. So the qualities you're looking for in a spouse is empathy, self-control, and ability to take responsibility for themselves. And if you get anybody who has a big problem in any one of these three, empathy, self-control, or ability to take responsibility for themselves, you may have found somebody that you're really not going to have a happy marriage with.
And so we kind of slightly want to define self-control a little bit, and I'm not the professional here, but I mean, we're not talking about like this person like eats fast food or something sometimes, you know what I mean? Or, you know,
you're looking for a long pattern of problems with self-control that never seem to get better.
Can you give some examples?
Yes, they're severe, and I'm going to share severe examples because I want you to understand that a lot of times the thing you're really worried about is probably something you could work out. Let's say your husband keeps talking to other women or other girls while you're dating, and you keep bringing it up, but
your boyfriend.
Okay. You keep bringing it up, but you keep finding him talking to other girls. And when you bring it up, he just tells you you're insecure. Why are you so insecure? Like, it's your fault that you brought that up. And then, on top of that, so it's like, yeah, everybody's allowed, like, a couple of rough spots. On top of that, you know that he cannot go more than a day without looking at pornography. And not only that, but he's not honest about it. He doesn't really share his feelings. He doesn't really get help or have support. So he's not able to take control. He's not able to care about how it affects you. And he's really not managing any self-control issues.
Or she.
Or she.
We're sort of out of time.
Oh, I want to share one more thing.
Okay.
So I will say, so I think you guys have heard the stat, like 50% of marriages end in divorce. And I want to say that stat, you have to actually hear how it's said. It is said 50% of marriages end in divorce, not 50% of people. And that is because there are serial divorcers in the world. And I'm just trying to give you hope. The thing is, divorce is I think it's more like 60 or 70% of people get divorced, which is a much higher rate. Don't get divorced.
Oh,
yeah. 60 to 70% of people do not get divorced.
Oh,
so again, going back to that 70-30 thing, that there are some people who really have stuff to get figured out before they can be in a healthy relationship. And you don't want to be with one of those people. Again, looking for, do they have empathy? Can they take responsibility? Do they have self-control? And can they respond to me when I give them feedback? That's when you know you found someone that's probably, no matter what's going on, you're probably going to be able to figure it out. There'll probably be lasting themes in your relationship you're always working on. That's fine. And the other 30%, yeah. But there's a good chance that most people in this room will have an awesome marriage. Okay.
Since we're out of time, I guess we'll just kind of close. Any last questions? We weren't sure really what we covered exactly.
Yeah.
So, but I guess like I just said before, I just challenge you to have faith, you know, even if you're not married and you're 32 years old and you've been in singles wards for a long, long, long time, I didn't give up and I'm really happy now and I'm glad I didn't. And so that's my testimony. Have faith, try to kind of quell that cynicism, have a little bit of hope, keep trying, keep dating. And, yeah.